the agenda is the approval of the agenda. Are there any items on the agenda as it stands that anyone wants to pull? I would like to pull A4, nursing home appointment. Anybody have anything else?
Not me.
If not, we'll take A4 after this. Is there a motion to pass the agenda as it's written?
So moved.
Less A4. Motion, is there a second?
Second.
We don't care. Either one else.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All right, now A4, this individual has a drug conviction on his record. And Willie May Curran has fought for years and years, anybody working with senior citizens, to not be appointed to these boards. And I, for one, do not want Willie May Curran after me. So not only that, but I agree with her. And I say that in the kindest way. She works so hard for senior citizens. I just cannot vote for this particular individual. Any other comments by any? Is there a motion to...
The name, forgive me, the name was submitted by the person or by who?
I don't have a clue. The application came through us through the Piedmont Triad Regional Council. That's from the Ombudsman.
I'm sorry, say it again.
Sorry. The Piedmont Triad Regional Council, the Ombudsman for the committee submitted the application.
Factual. It is factual. Tori's had a conversation of the drug charges 7 or 8 years ago.
Is there a motion to appoint this individual?
Is that public record?
His application would be
is that conviction public record?
It should be. Right. Yes, sir.
Do we know what kind of drug conviction?
No, sir. Just no, it was.
Is there a motion? Hearing none.
Motion for your motion for what? Denial?
Either way. I'll ask if there's a motion for denial. I'll make the motion.
I'll second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor of the motion, please signify.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. All right, the first item, or next item, I'm sorry, is Alamance County Training Facility Presentation. Sheriff Johnson, Darrell Russell, and Dr. Gatewood are here on that. Sheriff, lead off.
Yes, sir.
First of all, let me say that I agree with a lot of the Saxpah Hall residents, how beautiful Saxpah Hall is. I played many a day of baseball down there beside the elementary school in Saxpah Hall. It is a quaint little village that's unique to Alamance County. Secondly, there have been no sites selected. We were looking at the Saxpah Hall site, we're looking at Swepsonville site, and any other site that could hold basically what we are really wanting to do. And at this time, the training center is just in a planning stage looking. We have the support of all the emergency service chiefs, fire chiefs, law enforcement chiefs, EMS, 911, every possible emergency service in Alamance County, as you have, I gave you a letter that they signed on to, and a lot of them here, if you would stand up if you're a fire chief, and the fire marshal's office. Some were here in the back room, but they've already left. We have been discussing a training center for some time, the chiefs have, and through ACC at our board there. There is a definite need for more intense specialized training for all emergency personnel in Alamance County. Certainly, it would save us money because we have sent people out of state many times to receive the training, which if we had a regional training center ran by the Alamance Community College, they could bring those individuals here to run trainings that we have to send people out for. A training center would enhance the caliber of training for all our emergency personnel in the county. It could bring outside agencies to Alamance County, which a charge could be made and money be made by the university or by the ACC. Certainly, it could help some economics here with money spent on gas, food, and lodging. And certainly, that's a feasible possibility. A regional training center would allow, at times, all emergency personnel to train together on simulated catastrophic events such as school shootings, if we had a training center. And believe me, we are not exempt from those type happenings in this county. We have had a couple situations in some of our schools where the schools had to be locked down, and we had a kidnapping at one of them that we later got the child back out of South Carolina. And these are just some of the things that we're looking at. Emergency service personnel would be better trained to deal with all emergency situations in our county. And when we're talking about emergency personnel, I'm talking about your EMS, your fire, your police, your 911 dispatchers, your Alamance County Rescue Unit, Sheriff's Office, and all law enforcement agencies. One of the things the guy said in here about Burlington, talked about that they wouldn't, you know, necessarily use it from day to day. Well, they would if we brought that specialized training to Alamance County. That's why those chiefs and fire chiefs signed on. They don't like having sent their people out. And they have a Burlington training center, but it is not big enough to accommodate the necessary things that we're needing in law enforcement, like a large enough driving track. And I can tell you commissioners know there are a lot of sheriff's cars and police cars wrecked in this city. Matter of fact, in the ice, we had a lady cream one of our sheriff's cars. A driving track is certainly needed here in Alamance County. And we are looking at developing this training center, if we can, with the commissioner's help and the citizens' help here in Alamance County. We do not have a training center in the Piedmont area. If we want to send somebody, we send them to Edenville up in the mountains or Salemburg down in Sampson County, which is the sand flea capital of the world. And believe me, it is. We are talking, and like I say, this is just in the planning stage. There's been, you know, we're trying to get committees together to look at this. But there's a need for a driving track here for our law enforcement emergency personnel, a firing range, a simulated burn house where firefighters can go in and go in burning house, which is not really burning, it's gas type stuff, to simulate what they would have to do in going into homes to save our kids and people. A fire tower, a physical training course, and classrooms for EMS, fire, 911 dispatchers, rescue, and law enforcement. And I have honestly talked to John Jordan down in Saxball. He said he would love to be able to have a couple of fields, soccer fields, on one section down there. That is not unfeasible situation, because this training center, and when it's operating, it's not going to be operating on 11, 12, 1, 2 o'clock in the morning, and certainly we don't look for it to be operated on the weekends. And certainly things can be worked out, I'm sure, through the college if they take over heading up this training center and make it community friendly, etc. And so we're here to ask the commissioners to be thinking about this and grant us the authority to move forward in exploring the possibility of a training center here, because it is a win-win situation, I think, for Alamance County and certainly the emergency service personnel. And certainly this has been talked about for several years, and when Dr. Gatewood got to the Alamance Community College's head, certainly it's really a great breath of fresh air, because he wants to move forward with things. And we need this here in Alamance County. So I would like, the chiefs want to say anything before Dr. Gatewood gets up here.
Hi, y'all. I'm Cliff Parker, Chief Police of Town of Elon, and the current president of the Elon College, or excuse me, the Alamance County Law Enforcement Executive Committee. And I would just like to say that we believe as a law enforcement group, as an emergency response group, as first responders, fire EMS, that a training center here would be beneficial to everyone. And that having a facility wherever it could be located in our county would be very beneficial, particularly to those of us that are from smaller departments and rely on our law enforcement partners to try to find places that we can train our personnel outside of our own facility, our own classrooms that we can gather. So, and I would like to also say that we appreciate the fact that those from Saxby Hall that spoke tonight, we recognize that there was they were not speaking against law enforcement or fire or EMS. We recognize that. We have mutual respect. We know that they do respect their law enforcement and emergency services community, and that they were just speaking on behalf of their area. And so we appreciate that, and we acknowledge it, and we recognize it. But any consideration on a training site would be much appreciated by the law enforcement community that I represent. Thank you.
Sheriff Johnson, how many acres are you think you would need for that?
Well, we're looking at that. They're getting out of the way of Carmen King just to look at it. But I'm going to tell you right now, you're probably not looking about 30 to 40 acres at the most out there. So what I'm saying, they would be land for what John Jordan and some of the people in the community I've talked to would want, as far as like soccer fields and something for recreation down there. We have no problem with that. Okay. We want to be community friendly wherever we go and whatever we do.
Thank you. Good evening, Chair Smith, members of the commission. Thank you for the opportunity to join Sheriff Terry Johnson tonight to speak with you about the possibility of a regional training center and what it could mean to Alamance County, to Alamance Community College, and the law enforcement and emergency response agencies that we serve. I'm actually excited about the prospect of this partnership. The partnership would provide the opportunity to develop a state-of-the-art training center. With a state-of-the-art training center, we can prepare our law enforcement and emergency response agencies to meet 21st century job needs of this county. As president of Alamance Community College, I want Alamance Community College to have Alamance County to have the best community college in the state of North Carolina. There is a direct correlation between educational attainment and a community's overall economic health. And that's why I believe ACC must provide the highest quality instruction and the strongest commitment possible to student success and workforce development. And that's sort of a synopsis of my vision for ACC and a regional training center, wherever it may be. Chef Johnson has eloquently addressed what a regional training center means to local law enforcement. Let me add a little bit to that. Alamance Community College has offered a basic law enforcement training program for the past 10 years. Our graduates transition into jobs with area law enforcement agencies and often beyond. Currently, as you are aware, we do not have a regional training facility. So we use a multiplicity of sites to offer our training. A regional training center would allow us to improve on the quality of our program, to increase the quality of BLET, as well as the other agency training. For the community, for job seekers interested in a public service or criminal justice career, it would mean increased opportunity. It would allow our instructors more time to focus on quality instruction without having to navigate the logistics of scheduling training at a variety of sites that are all sort of ad hoc. A regional training center would be a boom to ACC's emergency medical services, our fire technology program. In fact, when the fire technology program began about 14 years ago, we were one of the first in North Carolina to offer the program. Alamance County was one of the pioneers in this field. Today, when our instructors and students need training in fire suppression and controlled fire stimulation, we must drive outside of Alamance County to various sites to utilize other counties and often, sometimes other community colleges, technology and equipment. At Alamance Community College, we're responsible for providing annual in-service training to area law enforcement. This is mandatory. This training is required by the state for all law enforcement to maintain the certification. It ensures that they are as good as they can be at what they do. A regional training center with state-of-the-art technology will bring us a reputation of having one of the top law enforcement training centers in the state, one that would bring recruits into the careers, and one that would develop our veterans so that they can provide our communities with the very best public service possible. Now, I'm not here to advocate this evening for a particular site. I want to be very clear about that. I am here to advocate for Alamance Community College and Alamance County to have the best training possible for its citizens and the best community college in this state. Now, I don't know how many of you may have played sports in your life, whether it's backyard, college, high school, maybe even professional. But you never go out to lose. And that's how I feel when it comes to training and educating our populace. We always want to win with the best education that we can provide. And that is one of the things that's going to move us truly into the 21st century in a very big way, is by educating our populace. So again, it's not about the site. I'm not that familiar to advocate for any particular site, but I'm truly advocating for education. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Gatewood. Sheriff, what are you looking for tonight?
Nothing, just permission for you folks to move forward through our county manager and looking at different sites and evaluating each site of, what is going to be needed, what can be done, what can't be done, on whatever sites that we see feasible to possibility of developing a training center. From there, I'll be honest with you, I'm going to start advocating to try to look at possible grants down the road once a site is selected to try to make it no taxpayer money as far as coming to the county through grants or even the governor's crime control or even drug seized asset monies from the sheriff's office,
You're asking this board to approve a feasibility study?
Yes, sir. That's what I'm asking.
I'd like to ask a few more questions first. I sat here for an hour and a half and listened to people speak, and now we want to do this in 5 minutes. I'd like to ask some questions.
Yes, sir.
I'm sorry. It is government as usual. At its max, what do you think it would cost to give you, put out there everything you want? The max. I mean,
if we had to pay for it?
Right. Well, it's going to cost money build the towers and everything that you want to do.
Well, certainly, I'm not a construction expert, but you're probably looking at $5-7 million.
Right. And where's that? You think that money's going to come from all grants?
There's some private people that does certain things that's already said they would do something like, say, a track, a firing range. And then certainly Governor's Crime Commission on grants to enhance emergency service personnel or services is available upon application, and we can prove a combined effort in a county. You also have your emergency services grants through the fire marshal's office and things with the state emergency coordinators.
Yeah, I think we've got to be cognizant of the fact that it's going to cost money to...
Oh, there's no... Hey, I'm not going to say it today, it'll cost money somewhere.
Now, here's a... you know, I don't know if we're thinking outside the box or not. You go over to Greensboro, I agree, towers are nice. Summerfield Fire Department, I go by there all the time when I go to Northwest Guilford High School. They have a house, a brick, two-story, with a huge fan on the end of it. And I looked at it for a long time, didn't even realize what it was. And it's right beside their fire department. And it's a training house, okay? The tower, I think Greensboro's got a huge tower on North Church Street.
They do.
If I'm not mistaken. How tall is the tower at Burlington's facility? Is that a two-floor or three-floor?
I won't say...
Three-four? It's probably about 35, 40 foot tall.
I was going to say probably three to four.
Okay. Now, we did an aerial photograph today of... I called and they did a Google. Burlington, is Smythe still here? Did he leave?
He had to leave.
Yeah, I'd like to meet him. They have a 3.5 acre, it was going to be 3.5 acre, it's right behind Andrews Elementary School. Mm-hmm. 3.5 acres. Now, do they use that at all for a driving course?
No.
Not at all?
No, they use a, I think they got a fire tower out behind the animal control, and they have a parking lot about as, probably as big as the sheriff's parking lot over there, and that we have been trying to do some driver, it's training on, and it's certainly not big enough.
Right.
And the space to expand, they even have a range out there, but they had to shut it down, you know. And
well, I think size it means a lot with this issue here. You know, you're talking about using only 30 to 40 acres. We did another aerial of, you ever been up to Moyock, Currituck, Blackwater's driving facility that's there?
I'm familiar with what you're talking about.
I know a person that trains people there. And their site is 134 acres. And they have multiple courses. They have asphalt. They have concrete. They join them together. They drive them separate. It's a total 6 miles if they put it all together. And it's on 134 acres. And I talked to him earlier today, and he told me that he didn't feel like what we were looking at least at the landfill, the current landfill, was big enough to do everything that we're talking about wanting to do, in his opinion. Well, in his opinion. We've got the landfill of 300 acres that we've got to do something with.
I don't care where it's at. Okay. But I'm telling you, I just want our people to be trained properly.
I would support further investigation as long as we just don't have unabated beliefs that it has to go down to the southern part of the county.
I initially was looking at the Swepsonville and was told maybe it was a better site and carried down to the dump and said this would be a better site. Certainly, the flatness of it is a better site. Secondly, to get to the Swepsonville land, I think we would have to buy some land to get across to get, or get an easement to get across to that. I don't care where the site is.
See, that there, in my opinion, was not in my backyard. Send it down to theirs. And it's my opinion about government, when they place infrastructure, there's infrastructure that you have to place that's mandated. You have to have water. You have to have landfill.
Yes, sir.
This is not mandated, and I think it would be nice. But areas pay a price to have infrastructure in their backyard. And I couldn't believe all the great comments tonight about how cordial they thought that our landfill was to the neighbors. I think they've paid a dear price to have that piece of what can be negative infrastructure in their backyard, especially when it comes to recycling. So I would respectfully ask that we look for other sites if we're going to go farther, and we really have to be cognizant of the fact that if we approve a study, we're approving going forward, number one. Number two, you're talking $5 million, and somebody's got to pay that.
And as soon as we see that we're moving forward, I assure you, there's going to be contacts made with people within the state to try to get commitments for some of the monies to produce the training center, whatever that may be. And I assure you, this ain't going to be something that's built overnight. It's going to have to be done in phases. First of all, a driving track, which all emergency service personnel can use, maybe second range, then, you know, a fire tower, firehouse, burn house, classroom space.
Do none of our volunteer fire departments have a firehouse, a practice facility?
Well, like I say, none of our volunteers, see, that's where they need this training center as bad as anybody.
Yeah, I support that, yeah. And the point is they could get together themselves and put up a centrally located firehouse, possibly, practice.
That's possibly, but...
Let me ask you this, and this will be my last question.
That's right.
How far is it, you know, if you're assuming you got Mebane over here, you got Elon over here, and you got, you know, the northern part of the county, but let's just say this for the sake of argument, from right here, Graham, North Carolina, Courthouse Square, how long does it take to drive, if you drive the speed limit, to get to the site?
You're looking at probably 12 miles, and certainly you go through the village of Swepsonville the way I go. If you go down 87, you're probably looking at 15 minutes from here to Saxbahal, if that much.
Yeah. And how long would it take to get to the other site?
To the other Swepsonville site?
Yeah.
You're probably looking at cutting it in half.
Right, okay.
Probably cutting it in half.
I think we have to be fair where we place infrastructure, especially when it's not mandated.
There's no doubt about that. And we also need to take into consideration the surroundings in those areas.
Mm-hmm.
And believe me, I would do nothing. Like I say, a lot of people in Saxbahal, I have a lot of friends down there. I grew up playing ball down in Swepsville and Saxbahal, playing ball. And some of those farmers spoke tonight, went to school with them, mm-hmm. you know. And I do care about what happens down there. That's why when we build, we need to make sure that we take in consideration every aspect of what we're doing as far as building a training center.
Now, is Allie here tonight?
Daryl Russell is. And also, to further with the discussion, there are probably more sites, but what we were looking at was property that was owned and controlled by the county.
Exactly.
And that was one of the issues we were looking at to try to keep the proposed costs down. And
absolutely.
I want to ask a question about the old landfill site. You know, how many of you, where is
it? There's Daryl.
Do you remember the National Guard Armory in Forsyth County? I want to say it was probably 40 years ago, roughly, that blew up, and it was on a landfill site.
I do.
Okay. Can you give us a little history of that? And
not in detail, I don't remember it. I just remember being on the news.
Yeah.
Before you get to that, Tim, what's the cost of the feasibility study, just that alone?
All right. 15 is what we're looking at, to look at the two sites that are owned by the county, and with some public informational meetings as well, is $15,000. And again, that would be to evaluate both sites that is owned by the county.
Mr. Sutton, I apologize.
No, it's fine. Yeah. What I was trying to point out is we can't use that site for anything else for all intents and purposes.
Let me ask the question.
Well, I went through with this. you can't use that site for anything else where there's much enclosure and you know, the methane gas and so forth. So an outdoor structure where it's outdoor activity probably is the safest use for that property, in my opinion, based on what, you know, I know about methane gas. So, and I'm sorry, Bill, I didn't mean to be rude there.
That is an issue that would need to be looked at during the evaluation. And so I don't know the answer yet to that.
Bill.
What I want to ask is, do we have an agreement with the farmers who sold that land that they would have a lifetime use of that land? If we do, I think we should keep it under our agreement.
We do.
I have an agreement.
We do have that agreement because I was involved in the purchase of that land from I don't know if it's in writing. Is it in writing? Part of the deed?
Mr. Smith, I believe the landfill director worked with the Ingalls. Mr. Ingalls Sr., Edgar, I believe his name was,
right. And
his wife Annie, to buy that 116-acre tract.
Right.
And then about 3 months later, we sold the home place back to these gentlemen here.
Yeah.
And I believe Greg Thomas has a gentleman's understanding that they can keep it under farm use just to keep trespassers off and continue using it for farm use. But I'm not aware of anything in writing. But Greg Thomas would be better able to answer that question.
Well, I know it was certainly discussed, and that was part of their agreement.
Mr. Ingalls got a comment here about that.
Can I bring this up to you?
Sure. Or to the chairman, whoever.
You would have this small print, wouldn't you?
Y'all get a picture of that.
It says right here, as part of the contract, this is the Times News by Robert Boyer. I didn't say that. The county also agreed to extend leases for the continued farming of corn, tobacco, and soybeans. So,
well, Mr. Chairman, we have an agreement that this board just approved last year for the old landfill for a gentleman to run dogs and hunt on.
Yeah.
And I'm just not aware of anything in writing for the Ingold property. There may be an agreement with Greg Thomas, but I don't believe it's been reduced to writing.
So back, when we bought the property from the county, remember me and my brother come to see you about doing all the paperwork.
Mm-hmm.
And I said something to you about, doing, we need to do a contract.
License. You have to be a license.
And it never was followed through. And then I said something to Greg Thomas one day when I talked to him, and never was followed through.
Well, if that's the board's wish, that's something the board can consider.
So, my brother and myself are very willing to pay land rent on it.
The original reason for purchasing that land was a buffer for the entrance to the landfill.
That's correct.
And at that time, the county did not think that it would ever be used. It can't be used for landfill expansion.
Right.
So we didn't think it would ever be used. That was the whole reasoning behind it.
Well, that's a good point. Can we get Greg? Can you comment? Can that land be applied for extension, further use, or?
Good evening, commissioners. It actually could in the future. Our goal with our current landfill is to have an infinite landfill. In other words, we've taken a landfill that originally was slated to last 40 years, and now the projections are 80 plus.
Without the buffer.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And that's because of good management.
Well, I like to think so. But in the future, who's to say 80 years, 100 years? My goal, again, is a perpetual landfill. In other words, we would never cross that road for landfill purposes. Now, anything on our side of the road, one of our speakers mentioned putting something on the landfill side. I would not be a proponent of that because we may expand our convenience center to have additional recycling. Recycling is going to be our life's blood in the future because that is the way we extend the landfill. The property across the road, Chairman Smith is exactly right. It was bought as a buffer, and there was a gentleman's agreement, I think, at that time.
Right.
And I was thinking that there was a $2 a year lease or
I don't think we ever entered into a written lease agreement.
Right.
No, it was, but after what I said, my brother and myself, I talked with you about it and it never was followed through.
But and I believe that we paid $631,000 for that piece of property, which was significant dollars in those days. And I know Mr. and Mrs. Edgar and Annie Engel had passed away.
Right.
And I think it was their son, I can't remember his name at this time, that orchestrated that. At that time, I think they needed some health care, and there was some concern about that. I don't know all the details on that, but that was the thought process at that time. But we paid a significant amount of money, not with the intent of putting a landfill there. Certainly, that's not our intent. But it is a viable piece of property. And my discussion with Sheriff Johnson, and I can't speak for Sheriff Johnson, but it is a viable piece of property. It is accessible. It really is. But the board ultimately would make the decision as to what if anything would go out there. And any information that I can provide certainly I'm willing to do so. Commissioner Sutton mentioned methane. And if we were to partner with ACC in the future with a joint venture, we could provide an alternative energy source in the form of methane generated from our landfill. At some point, we're going to have to recover that when we reach Title V, which would be 3 million tons in place, and that'll be a few years. But we will have to do something at that point. So that's a good question, or a good comment, I'm sorry. Gentleman's agreement, again, with that property.
They used to work.
As far as the gentleman's agreement, you know, with my
should still work.
You talk about, you know, need this and need that. I said, one thing for sure, none of it, anything is possible without a farm.
Right. And there's some concerns on our end with the landfill as we continue to expand. We've had a tremendous amount of break-ins at our landfill. We have, as I've mentioned, the most valuable fiscal asset that the county owns at the landfill, with hundreds of millions of dollars worth of airspace. We've got a lot of equipment. We had tremendous break-ins last year. I would like to see a more of a law enforcement presence closer to us. I know his sheriff's detectives have spent a lot of time out there. That's the concern that we have. As we continue to grow, we've got a $500,000 recycling and processing facility that will be coming online in April. We're excited about that. Just a lot of potential at the landfill. We provide 20 jobs for families in Alamance County that not at the expense of tax dollars. So we are an economic stronghold, really, for the county. The land, again, I think was a gentleman's agreement.
May I ask the sheriff if we heard comments about helicopters, toxic fumes, all kinds of, any of that going on?
No, sir, I don't think there'll be no toxic fumes down there. I won't sit here and tell you there won't be a helicopter coming there. So if somebody got hurt out there on the driving track or something, had to bring Chapel Hill helicopter in there, it'd probably come in there. But other than just helicopters hoving around, no, that's not going to happen.
So what would a burning building create?
Wait a minute.
Good question.
We're going to keep this. We're not going to have a big debate about it tonight. Anything else, Sheriff? Anything else from the board? Tim?
Well, the money for the study would come from where?
Drug forfeiture money that is in the sheriff's department. He still has some state drug forfeiture as well as federal drug forfeiture that we can use. So it would not be county general fund dollars.
And we have to approve that dispersion.
Yes, sir.
John, anybody else?
if I said we've not spent any money on this concept at this point. This has all been an idea that we're trying to flush out, and again, we didn't feel like we could flush it out really without having some type of study done to get the facts and also to do a master plan to see what would be feasible and what's not feasible. So
what would the feasibility study include?
I did give you a copy of the draft from Allie Williams, Carmen King. It should be in front of you. It would meet with county personnel and others as needed to finalize the size and location of all elements, perform a limited environmental review of the site, develop a sketch plan showing the size and location of elements, finalize the preliminary master site plan including possible phasing, and provide a estimate of probable costs. Again, this would be, if this was approved, this would just be the first step. There would still have to be a noise and safety step that is included as well, which would be an additional study that we would have to look at. And preliminary discussion with Daryl is just the tabletop look for each site would be about $6,000, and then a more in-depth study of the safety and noise issue would be about 20. Is that fair?
Mr. Honeycutt and Mr. Chairman. If I may add a little bit about the old landfill, Commissioner Sutton has some questions relative to that. One challenge there would be we could not put structures on the cap of that landfill. In other words, where trash has been covered and it's been capped off, by state regulations, you cannot place building structures on top of that. Now, that being said, it's not all capped off. There is virgin territory across the river to the tune of about 85 acres. And the sheriff mentioned that and accessibility. The challenge there would be to purchase property to access that without building a bridge across the river, which would be very expensive. So that's part of the equation. Certainly there's a lot of land there. There's been mention of a park on that 85 acres, riding trails, and certainly it's a good piece of property for something like that. But I just would mention that.
How much of the area is capped, as you say?
You're going back in the 70s, pre-me, and I'd be afraid to say definitively. I know about.
Are they talking about an enclosed building or an open? Could you do an open air? We're going to get all this in a feasibility study.
That's right. That's right. And I'm just mentioning that for your benefit.
Last question on my part. If we do a feasibility study, would we still have an up or down vote later to move forward?
Yes, sir. And again, this was nothing. We didn't feel comfortable as staff to make recommendations on this because there's environmental issues to look at with the landfill. There was siting issues for a range for safety issues. There was siting issues for a track and a burn house. We were not comfortable making that recommendation, and we didn't have the expertise. And that's the reason why we did contact Allie Williams, Carmen, and King to bring us a recommendation to help us walk through that process, because we can't definitively tell you one is better than the other at a staff level, or it'll work at a staff level.
Would we have to do this feasibility study of the same nature if we just want to look at the old landfill site to see what we could do with it? Would it be the same type of study, or would it be?
Same type of study. We were looking at, as part of the $15,000, it was doing both sites. And again, not saying that those are the only two sites in Alamance County, but those were the only two large parcels that we had control of. And we were looking at trying to reduce the cost or keep the cost down. But again, there may be other sites out there. You know, if somebody wants to donate 100 acres, we'd be glad to look at that as well.
Well, but I guess let me rephrase.
I'm sorry.
If we said, hypothetically, we want to study the old landfill site as to what we can do with it.
Yes, sir.
Period.
Yes, sir.
Would this be the same type of study?
Yes, sir.
Technically. Yeah. Would it have to be amended or anything? I mean, this would be what we would want to see, right?
Yes.
Whether we plan this or not. All right, someday we got to do that anyway.
Right. Well, and we again, we were looking at both, doing the same thing at both sites.
Yeah. Anything else from the board?
And if I could question, Daryl's here now, if you decide not to do the Saxba Hall site, you know, if there is that gentleman's agreement, and again, that's a board decision on that. If we only had to look at one site that the county would the cost be $7,500?
It would. I would still want to include the noise.
Right. Right.
That.
So probably up to 15.
It would be about the same.
Right. Including the noise and safety assessment on the tabletop look, we're still talking about $15,000.
Is there a motion?
So moved.
I'll second. Any more discussion on the feasibility study?
Are we capping this at 15,000? The motion.
Yes.
Second.
And this will be for the Swepsonville site only. Swepsonville site only. Is that what we're saying?
That's what I'm thinking. Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Are we capping it at 7,500?
Since we have
the other issue I would suggest with the board is to instruct staff to begin working on that agreement and making sure we do put that in writing.
Okay. That's good. Then are you capping it at $7,500?
Or $15,000. That includes the sound study.
I thought it was cut in half if we only went with one site.
Well, we would have to do the sound study. That was an additional cost.
All right.
Hold on.
I just want to add one.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
I've been hearing a lot.
So have we.
I'm sure you have. The noise and safety issue is something we're all concerned about, and that had not been included in the initial proposal. And we've actually talked to an out-of-town expert that does these type of studies, and I would want to use them as a team member to look at this issue. It is an important issue. So that would be included for one site. The $15,000 should cover that.
We're just looking at one site, right?
That's correct. All right. And this would give you the information I think you would need to make an informed decision. It is an important decision.
Mr. Smith, would you repeat your motion?
My motion.
Second.
They say it was to exclude Cycle Hall and include the other place with all the things that he's asking. He's saying he's going to take in
and cap it at 15,000.
And cap it at 15,000.
That's it. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carried. It's me. Hopefully, got it. This is a long meeting. Let me say, I said these remarks about the landfill and its longevity. And I didn't say that just because of the good management, because we have had excellent management. But the longevity on that landfill in the last 5 years has increased almost 50 years or more because of management and because of new things that are coming down. But Greg and his staff have done an outstanding job. That is a state-of-the-art enterprise. All right, Mr. Manager, next item.
The next item that we have is in front of you is a resolution with respect to the Human Relations Commission, or Council, excuse me. And there's been a lot of discussion about the county's role in respect to the Human Relations Council, and our role has been we have funded it at about $1,500 a year, but we have not funded them in approximately 4 years. So there's not been a funding issue, but this board has been responsible for appointing their 20-member board. And I think there's been some concern with the board about they are a separate 501c3. About just separating ourselves from them, let them do the activities that they so choose, and not have that board oversight in the board appointment. If I think that was what was discussed at our last meeting as well. And in front of you is that resolution.
Any questions? Any comments?
Move that we adopt the resolution.
Is there a second?
Second.
Sure. Moved and seconded. Sorry, this is not open to the public. Any further comments? All in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes. Budget amendment number 77, Health Department. Anybody here? Mr. Manager, you want to take that?
Barry's here.
Oh, Barry here.
Yes, sir.
I'm sorry, Barry.
And our new interim.
Didn't see you come in. I'm sorry.
So, no, we were just hiding back in the back, watching all the fat building.
I would like to take this opportunity to introduce to the board Stacy Saunders, and Stacy is going to be the interim beginning at 5:01 on the 28th of February. So I take the opportunity for you all to meet her. We're looking forward to having her work in that role with the health department.
Hey, Stacy.
And so you have before you a budget amendment that we have for $2,500. And this money was provided to us by the Food and Drug Administration for our voluntary participation in the National Retail Food Regulatory Program. And what this is our environmental health folks worked to help implement the food code in North Carolina. We were a pilot project to take that food code and implement it and use it in Alamance County. And this was a model that was adopted by the state for our food code that was adopted last year. So in recognition of the good work that was done by our environmental health staff, the agency was awarded $2,500, and as you can see, we propose buying a computer with that for $1,750, and medical supplies at $750, totally $2,500.
Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. Yes, sir.
Barry. Is this the last time we'll see you, Barry?
In this well, it depends on how you define that, sir. I hope this is the last time you're in an official capacity.
That's correct, right?
Yes, sir. You're certainly invited to come visit us. Thank you, sir.
And Barry's retirement is scheduled for the 28th from 3 to 5 at the health department.
That's correct, in our classroom.
Yeah.
I'm certainly invited. Hope to see you. And after that, I hope to get really involved in the community, and I'll probably be up here speaking on various and other things.
Thank you for your service, you. Barry, and good luck.
Yes, sir. Thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you.
All right, tax lien advertisements. Jeremy.
Commissioners, thank you for giving me the opportunity to come up here and speak, and I'll try to keep it brief. It's that time again, time to advertise our tax liens. General Statute 105-369A requires the tax collector to report to the governing body the total amount of unpaid taxes for the current fiscal year that are liens on real property. Upon receipt of the report, the governing body must order the tax collector to advertise the tax liens by publishing each lien at least once in a newspaper having general circulation within the county. The advertisement cost is assessed to each real property parcel and is added to the unpaid tax bill, so there's no additional cost to us. The folks that are advertised, when they do pay, cover their own costs. The tax collector has determined a cost of $5 should be added to each unpaid real property parcel. That's the same amount we've had the last few years. That seems to be working very well for us. Bankruptcy law prevents the advertising of taxes filed under a bankruptcy claim. Therefore, no 2013 tax liens under bankruptcy will be advertised. Those will be removed from our advertisement. As of January 31st, the total amount of liens against real property is $3,714,469.93. This is actually an encouraging number for me. This is less than it was previously. In fact, every evening before I go home, I check that collections rate to see how we're doing. And we're running about a percentage ahead of what it was last year at this time. Normally, when you get to advertisement, you may have 6% of the tax base still needing to be advertised. We're on course to be just 5%. And 1% in our business is quite a substantial number. So payments have been good. Alamance County Tax Administrator requests that the Alamance County Board of Commissioners approve the lien advertisement of unpaid real property parcels for tax year 2013 at a cost of $5 per parcel. I recommend advertising around March 20th. That's basically the same date as one day off from what it was last year. To allow adequate time to process all payments and ensure citizens who have paid by February 28th are not advertised. We guarantee that anyone that pays by the end of February will not be included in the advertisement. Obviously, at some point we have to pull the plug and run the file. So in March, I can't make that guarantee, but that would ensure that the folks that pay in February are not in the advertisement. All I need on that is just an approval, and we'll be good to go forward with that.
Is there a motion?
I make that motion.
Second. Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? Thank you, Jeremy. With the board's approval and I'm sorry, Jeremy, for this late thing, but I would like to carry over the spotlight on the tax department, and thank you very much, but we do want it,
and
we'll reschedule.
We'll do that at our next morning meeting.
That'd be great.
Yes, sir.
Finance officer's report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I as well will be brief. Good evening, commissioners. I have the proposed schedule for the budget process this year. I was hoping to meet with the budget committee. The weather prevented that. I do have hard copies for each of you. We'd like to distribute it. It's also on the screen. We'd like to just take just a couple of minutes and describe the budget process. It's a little bit different than it has been in the past. If we distribute one, Susan Roberts is also in the room. As finance manager, we've been working to establish a budget calendar for all of the departments within the county as well as the outside agencies. I won't read every line here, but basically the department budgets were originally scheduled to be returned to the county finance department on last Friday. The snow has kind of delayed that a couple days. We do expect those to come in this week. In addition, this week, the volunteer fire department request packages are going to be distributed, as well as those packages for the outside agencies. What is different about this year is, at the suggestion of Chairman Smith, we've decided to create a budget committee. Those members are Chairman Smith, Commissioner Sutton, County Manager Craig Honeycutt, Susan Roberts, and myself, to entertain and discuss with each department their specific needs. In the past, we've had a budget retreat where the only groups that have actually presented to the board have included the school system, the community college, and the sheriff's department. This year, we'd like to have the opportunity for all departments and agencies to present their needs to that budget committee. Certainly, all commissioners are invited to attend these sessions, as well as they will be open to the public. Brief schedule there that you see. What our hope is that the first week of March we would able to have, and you see the highlighted areas there in yellow that the budget committee would actually meet. The week of March 3rd, we would have a schedule of each of the departments in approximately 30 minutes scheduled to present their needs to the county budget committee for the next fiscal year. Again, we would then meet with the outside agencies the week of March 24th to do the same thing, getting back together with the adjusted request to estimate revenues the day of April 7th, which actually follows our regular commissioners meeting of that day. We would then receive the volunteer fire department budgets on April 8th. Their boards normally meet the first week of the second quarter. And then we would have the budget committee meet to review all the departments and outside agencies to present to the board at the regular meeting on April 21st. With your consent, we would like to be able to proceed on this basis. The one thing that will be handled a little bit differently this year in the past, in addition to these meetings for the budget committee, is I would suggest that County Manager Craig Honeycutt and myself meet with school superintendent and the school finance officer to discuss their specific budget needs and the process for that that would then also be brought to the budget committee the week of April 7th. Mr. Chairman, that's my request. Again, it's on the board. Be happy to answer any questions from budget committee members or the full board.
Is there a motion to accept the finance officer's schedule?
My own committee appointment.
Does it fit your, your schedule?
Yeah, you did talk about a time. What time would the meeting start?
Well, what we were hoping, Commissioner Sutton, is that the week of March 3rd through the 7th, then I think we need to meet with to get with you and Chairman Smith to see when you all are available. But our hope is to have the departments meet here where we basically would entertain them, but it would be subject to your schedule availability.
Okay. Is it then by consent the board approves this?
Yes.
Any objection to that?
No.
Thank you, Tom.
Congratulations on the information you provided on the graphic that was in the Times this morning. It's beautiful.
Thank you.
Y'all see this?
Yeah.
Sure.
Mr. Manager?
No updates at this time, except that I'm hungry.
Any commissioner comments? Hearing none, is there a motion to adjourn? All in favor?
Second.
Say aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to